Ladies and gentlemen, this is the Board of Selectmen meeting of December 15th, the last of the calendar year, hard to believe. At the end of the board, this board meeting, we will have an executive session regarding DPW union contract negotiations. But before we get to announcements and the meat of the meeting, we have in our normal business, we have a special presentation tonight. Town Clerk, Ms. Lydia Zish, come forward.
Every few years, it's my honor as the town clerk to submit to the selectmen a candidate for the Boston Post Golden Cane Award, which is presented to the oldest resident living in the town of Hatfield. It is my pleasure this year to present this award and a certificate of recognition to Marjorie S. Kowalski.
Hey, I'm going to be fancy for
Turn around, face the camera, and stand here. Turn around.
You want me to hold that?
You hold that. Okay.
Turn around.
Yeah.
Marjorie has just celebrated her 97th birthday. She lives at 38 West Street in West Hatfield, where she has lived her entire life. Marjorie has served the town for many years. As a member of the Real Folks Society at the Congregational Church, Marjorie would be at every town election selling church baked goods, many of which I'm sure she made herself. Marjorie was also the postmaster for the West Hatfield Post Office, which was located in her home for over 40 years. I grew up in West Hatfield, and as a child, I loved walking to the post office with my sister to go pick up the mail. Marjorie was always cooking something really good in the back. It was the best smelling post office in town. On behalf of the selectmen and the entire town of Hatfield, congratulations, Marjorie.
Thank you. Go back.
Congratulations.
You want me to make a speech?
Yes. It's your turn.
Marjorie.
Thank you, everybody, for coming. I certainly am very happy with this honor. It's a long lot of years, but they've passed very quickly because I've always had good friends and a lot to do.
Good job. Congratulations.
Thank you.
Take her.
We're going to go right out. No. We're going to go right out the door.
She wants to stay for the meeting. It's okay.
Good job, Lydia.
Did you and Paul write an invitation to be on? I even asked you that. Did I on a team? Yeah, I'm going to mention that here.
I'll never see it. You ready? Announcements. We will have some information about the luminarium very shortly, but before that, there are two letters I'd like to just read extracts from. You know, we often hear some of the negatives about town and town employees, but it's also very nice to hear some positive things. And here are two things that just came in very recently to the DPW. I won't name the individuals who sent them, but today we had a sewer backup in our home, and I caught it early enough to limit damage. I called Tony Listowski and got Brian McGrath and Ken Holhut, who came ASAP, checked the main lines, and then came into our cellar to try and help unclog or see if there was something on the town's end. They went well beyond what was expected of them, and yet treated it like it was their responsibility. I have to say a huge thank you for their efforts. They were so polite, helpful. I called someone who came within an hour, and it was all repaired. In any city of the world, I cannot imagine this kind of a response, help, or concern for the homeowner in such a situation. This town is always impresses me, and here again is no exception. We have much to be proud of, so thank you for having such great, committed help. Mm-hmm. So that was one nice letter. And here is the second one, and this had to do with illegal dumping of trash in the area along Brook Hollow and Little Neponset Roads. Mr. Genovese, I'm lapse in writing this note. I did notice over the weekend that the debris was cleared up. It was so nice to go by and not having to look at that couch, the rusted out drums and other trash. Thanks so much for taking such quick action. It's greatly appreciated by myself and others who, like me, walk along these roadways. Whoever was sent to do the job did a fantastic job. Anyway, congratulations, DPW. It's very nice. Are there any other announcements? Mm-mm. No. Public forum?
Oh.
Anyone? Public forum? Okay. Mr. Racklebush?
Yes, good evening. Two of the three selected. I'm sorry Brian's not here because he was going to be involved somewhat with the luminarium per last year myself.
He may be here later. He's working. He's on the telephone.
So this is the 35th anniversary of the Hatfield Luminarium, a tradition that is now known by everybody who lives in town, but always appreciated, as I hear it, from people who come to town for the first time. Not too much of a change in any kind of a schedule. I'm very happy to have Marlene and Key helping now. We can still work on that some more, but we'll get that part of it. The 4:30 time is when it really starts with refreshments and holiday story time at the library. The story time is at 5 o'clock. 5:45, everybody in town have their candle lighting complete. The holiday program will hopefully take place as it's written here on the steps of the town hall, because the weather seems to be possibly breezy, but not rainy, which is the worst. And that, of course, features the Smith Academy Brass Ensemble, who lead the caroling, which makes it ever so nice. Small town, Norman Rockwell, kind of a picture for people who come from out of town. And then it concludes with a visit from Santa, who's all ready with his elf, and he's not quite ready with his candy canes yet. 6:30, I'm so glad to have the fire department back involved. And I did suggest to your son.
Stephen.
That one of the things they used to do, not the bake sale, I didn't think they did that then, but I don't think they're going to do that. It's maybe a bit commercial. But they did do, which was very useful, a fire safety table where they had, you know, the dangers, et cetera. And then they also used to sign up folks to do the seniors, if they wanted a home inspection. So that's a great venue because it's the most public that the fire department, I think, gets all year long is at the luminarium. Then, although it says here 7, though there is a prelude start to the Congregational Church, and that's the 20th annual bell and choral concert. My heavens, that one does strike me. It includes this prelude, as it mentioned. Then there's a handbell quartet, the Joyful Ringers, some soloists, Harry and Adams, fiddle music, a cappella, choir. All on a listing. Oh, I didn't give you any of these.
Do you have this?
No.
Sorry.
It's all right. You just give it to Jeff.
Thank you.
You can share it.
Thank you.
Did you get one of these?
Thank you.
So that's pretty much the setup. I do need to make a mention about the signage. Remember last year, Phil, dealing with where did our signs go? And this is the sign that's out by the triangle by the interstate. That is actually state property. And for about 4 years, I've been chasing, not each successive year, but chasing signs, trying to get out there first thing Monday morning, get that sign back because it's gone otherwise. And this year they got it before the luminarium. So we can't put it there because it's state property, and although the tag sale signs can be there. So any suggestions as to where a sign should be? I'm thinking of just, we got it back. Jimmy LaValle got it back today. So where that sign should be, I guess the best, I've tried to have every entryway into Hatfield covered. North Hatfield with the facility is for sewage or whatever, and then on Route 5 every way in. But the closest one is, what, Elm Court there, as you come up down from the railroad tracks coming from 5. So unless somebody has an in with the department or a better idea. Yeah, that's. But the signs have been, we've been losing signs. There was a dozen once upon a time, and now there's 8. So, and there are Memorial Day signs that Billy Zisch had made, your long predecessor, and they are for the Memorial Day, which never go out, so could be that we maybe make some of the signs into Hatfield, luminarium signs. Next thing is I'd like to form a drink of water. And glasses. I'm looking for Hatfield luminaries. And these are folks who'd like to join a Hatfield Luminarium A team, which would be advocacy, advice, action to explore potential for Hatfield's day and night to shine. There's many possibilities culturally, educationally, that we could add to our program so that there's stuff in the afternoon, for instance, at the elementary school. So that'll be forming, and there are some folks already on the invitation list to join that. And if you, anybody is out there interested in joining this to explore, you know, how Hatfield could make better use overall, not use, but more rounded, with it could eventually become a Massachusetts cultural event, if that's a direction we want to go. I won't go into that now. So if you're interested, should it be you, or should it be Key, or both of you, who could be contacted at the town hall?
Sure, either one of us.
Either Key, or Marlene, and a copy of that might be a copy of the invitation, I'll make it up, would be maybe standing on the desks of some of the offices, or so people can see it. So 2-3 weeks, maybe after your next meeting, we'll see if anybody shows up for that. I don't want to do this next year on my own. I mean, it's been helpful to have the DPW, et cetera, help, especially from town. But this really has the opportunity to become a Hatfield event, you know, that's more widespread. So 35-year tradition. I think that's it, unless you have to. I'm meeting with Steve, with your son tomorrow, and see what that talk about the fire department's opportunity here. But there's many other things, you know, the school at candle making, for instance, different ways of making lanterns, different ways of, and then comparing it to, I wanted to do once a summer solarium, 15 hours and 20 minutes, or 16 hours, 17 hours of daylight, summer solstice, winter solstice, 9 hours and 4 minutes here. So interesting to compare. We light the night, but in the summer, you know, we have all the light we want. So just, again, educationally interesting to notice how we do on the 42.2 parallel north. That's it. Any questions?
Not at this point.
The only comment, I do appreciate your personal involvement this time around, very belatedly, coming back to you cap in hand, and you're picking it up and running it, helping coordinate all of those things.
No problem, yeah.
And as I understand it, Chief Gaughan has volunteered Firemen's Association to help out in the future,
yep.
Orchestrating this. So.
However we can, this can be synergized, or whatever the right word is, so much the better.
Well, thank you very much. Appreciate it.
Thank you, Peter.
Town administrator, we're going to take up Mr. Frew's.
I will. Mr. Frew is the license holder for 72 School Street, doing business as Best Little Market in Hatfield. And I'd just like to read for the record in key. I will make sure you have a copy of this. Mr. Frew could not be here this evening, so he sent an email. Let this email formally serve to report the subject liquor license serves as collateral for contractual indebtedness I have to U.S. Small Business Administration, together with liquor vendors. I remain obligated to, in connection with the above-named business enterprise, which was the recent subject of a November 6th foreclosure, where the resale of said real estate was finalized last week on December 9th. My respectful and humble request is that the Board of Selectmen rule favorably on my renewal application to the extent I can obtain a limited extension or transitional license for a period up to 120 days, so that I may conclude dutiful efforts toward the planned sale of said transitional license to a qualified purchaser. And in brackets, no alcohol will be sold under said license, with a term period slash maturity until Friday, April 29th, 2016. So Mr. Frew has completed his liquor license renewal process. I have had a conversation with the representative at the Alcoholic Beverages Control Commission. And the reason for putting this into the record is that we need to be on record with Mr. Frew, that if the Board of Selectmen wishes to, not wishes, we need to give him notice, and we may give him up to 6 months to transfer that license. So that is my recommendation to the board.
Is there a motion to approve renewal of a 2016 retail packaged goods store to Best Little Market in Hatfield Incorporated, doing business as Hatfield Market, for a period of 180 days, unless earlier suspended, canceled, or revoked?
Could we put in there not to exceed, or is it? Do you think it's necessary, 180 days?
Okay, for a period not to exceed?
Exceed 180 days. That way we have a specific indication as to closure. And I'll second the motion.
Okay, the motion's been seconded and as amended. Any other discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Ron, are you the only one here from assessors? Are you the only one participating from assessors?
I said 6 o'clock, about 6 o'clock.
Okay.
Just trying to judge what we had.
Okay.
Nope, yeah. No problem. We'll go on with DPW. Yeah. DPW?
Well, thank you, Mr. Chairman. Just some updates. The water improvement project, the transmission main project, the line has been tested under I-91 and passed the test, so that portion is complete. Last Friday, they started at the pump house on Brockway Smith's property. They had to shut the water off there. I want to thank Dan Christopher over at Brockway. It was a sure effort on his behalf as well to shut down the whole plant over there. It took some meetings, but we came to that date of when to shut down his plant. And it went well. The water was shut off. They hooked the valves up out there and then started up the easement towards Chestnut Street. Today they stopped right at Chestnut Street, so that is complete. So the only thing left is to jack under the railroad track. So
Have they decided whether to do it
know.
This year?
I didn't talk to them today because they were just finishing up down there where some stuff they had to do on that easement. But I surely will touch base with them, hopefully. The weather looks good, so if that's the case, I hope that they're going to jack that pipe underneath the tracks.
So that's the last.
That's the last
piece of that.
Correct.
Yep. Portion of the project.
Yeah. So, hopefully.
No, that's right.
Okay.
the Main Street sidewalk improvements. I've been having a few conversations with Ryan from CEI, the engineering on site. We've been discussing some tree options out there, and the sidewalk's all in place. It's all backed up. All the driveway aprons are complete. So it's just a matter of coming back in the spring and doing the markings, putting the handicap plates in the sidewalks, and the tree planting. So, I mean, we have some residents where we did take some trees away from because of the sidewalks, and they had some concerns about what was going to be replanted there. So we're working with them on it, and same with the market. So, but it's going well. They did a great job. I haven't seen an invoice, so, you know, to apply to Mass Works. But anyways.
And they have until, well, you have until 30 June of next year.
Correct.
To complete the project. So we're.
I mean, it was just, you know, we're grateful of the weather. I mean, they did the whole project, so, you know, I, you know, 90% complete, 95% complete at this time of year. We were thinking only getting 1,000 feet in. The Prospect Court Bridge update, I talked to Steer Engineering last week, and I updated, it just happened at Bob Wagner was in town hall about the CPC funding. We're on track. They were up there last week to do the final inspections. Nothing was flagged.
This was the underwater inspections?
Yep. Nothing's flagged. I mean, everything's moving ahead, so we're looking to bid it the first part of January. So that'll be out to bid in January, and hopefully we'll get some reasonable pricing.
What's the target date anticipated to start that whole construction
piece,
or at that point then?
I don't think they'll start it to the spring. I think they're just going to get the bid out.
Okay.
Because that's going to be, you know, at least 30 days, so February. It won't start till March, probably.
Okay.
April. North Street Sewer, the project's just about complete. They were tying in a few more services. They milled, they reclaimed the road up to the point where they did, hopefully tomorrow, if they got it graded tonight. I don't know if they did. They were supposed to work late up there and grade it. And I hope that they're thinking of putting in the base coat tomorrow. While the blacktop, they can still get the blacktop out of Palmer. So hopefully that's going to be done
tomorrow.
When
do the plants close?
Really, the plants are closed, but Palmer's open till Christmas. So
hopefully
they finish the grading, the final grading, and they're going to do it. They're just going to do a little bit of temporary work on the driveway aprons to go through the winter. Then next year, we're going to go in there and put the top on. So, but another project, due to the weather, was able to be completed this construction season. So,
excuse me. Yes, Mike.
Question.
Sure.
For the DPW director. So, about North Street. Much to my dismay and to the dismay of a couple of other residents who really weren't kept informed as to what was transpiring. It was the expectation, I think, on the part of most people on North Street that the sewer that was going to be replaced, it was going to go from King all the way to the corner, the round corner on North Street, to tie into the newer section of sewer, if you will. And apparently what's transpired is that that's not happening. There will be still about 500 feet of North Street's old, aged sewer, which will not be replaced under this project. And we didn't find out about that until today when somebody spoke to the engineer and he was kind of conveying that.
Yeah.
So can you share with me and perhaps the rest of the residents of North Street what the future plan is for the rest of that old aged sewer, and also the water line that's on North Street, which has been problematic as well, and which at one point was on the capital plan?
And still is. And still is, but the price, you know, the price for the North Street project for the water is almost $800,000. So,
yeah,
but the last piece of that sewer, I'd like to put it at, I'd like to complete that from where they ended to that manhole where the new sewer is tied in.
Right. So are you proposing that as part of the capital plan for next year, Phil, or what's the...
I don't even know if it'll be that much to put in front of the capital committee to go to that little distance.
Okay, and how about the repair of the road, that section of the road, because from where they're going to put that base coat on tomorrow all the way to Main Street is just absolutely horrendous.
And that's in the capital plan for Chapter 90 funding this coming construction season, this spring.
Okay.
Because our thoughts are that the water line isn't going to happen, and I mean, that's the worst road in town. So, I mean, it's time to do it and not wait. You know, I mean, we just can't wait any longer to see if the water line money is going to be available.
So looking ahead to the next fiscal year, it's likely then...
It's going to get overlaid.
And that the rest of that sewer would be completed.
Yes. Yeah. I mean, I'm meeting with the engineers on Monday, so.
Okay. Thank you.
The fire station corrective actions. Something came to light in the last few days here about the existing contract. The general contractor that did the project.
Yes.
I don't know if Marlene. Marlene got.
Oh, that was just today.
Today.
I just received today. Oh, I thought you were talking about the work that needs to be done over there for the gutters and. Okay.
Yes.
You're talking about the construction of the building.
The only thing that isn't part of that, and it still might be, in my feeling, is even the gutter system. Is that everything that they've most of the things that they've identified is due to the construction. Under the contractor. So Evergreen has put in a request for some payment, and
they've submitted two. I received two pay recs today. I had a telephone conversation with Mark Gillott, and I was just going to update the board a little later on, but they are requesting, you know, it does not state that the project is final. But they're looking to, you know, be compensated. And I believe that is a result of a couple of emails I received from two different subcontractors. They have not been paid by the general contractor. Mm. So that would be the reason why the general contractor is submitting those pay recs.
So contractually, where are we? Right. Well, some of the things that the fire folks have brought up concerned where the downspout is, it drips right in front of the door,
right.
The lock on the door,
the
cleaning, what the cleaning is to be, mm-hmm. what the schedule of that is in the new contract, mold. Mm-hmm. Apparently there was a leak in the fire department area.
Mm-hmm.
The mold.
Now, some of those things are not... As a consequence of
right,
but the bigger ticket items are, you know, as far as the door, the sidewalk heaved a little bit because you can't open the door, you know.
Yeah.
And my feeling is that we don't release any money till the punch list is complete, because I know Mark Gillott had produced a punch list at the end
yes.
of the project, and they never came and addressed any of the issues. So that has to be complete.
Okay, so you're working together and
the contract
with
the town
Mark.
Has with Mark Gillott has expired.
Yeah.
So if there's any work we'd like him to do, he's going to need to be paid for those services.
Okay. Well, just don't ignore it then.
No.
Do what we're supposed to do and put on a contract what they're supposed to do.
Absolutely. But I know that, you know, the punch list was in front of them and they had never addressed it. So to give them their final payment that they're asking for is out of the question.
Just curious, Phil, you maybe don't know at this point, but what percentage does that represent of the total contract that's being withheld? Is it going to be sufficient, you know, to take care of any outstanding or actual outstanding problems or potential problems?
Well, the original contract sum was $437,000. There was a change order for about $6,200.
Mm-hmm.
They're looking for about $51,000.
Is that enough to keep out there to?
Oh yeah.
You know,
to cover down the punch list items.
Yes, yeah. Exactly.
Absolutely.
there's enough of incentive there.
Yeah.
Okay, that's fine. That's all
2 years
know.
Later, there's enough.
Well, it is what it is. Unless there's a penalty clause in the original contract, what do we do?
Yeah. They have been paid quite a bit of money already.
Right. No, I understand
the pay recs,
as they should.
For pay recs I have are about 50 plus.
I don't have a problem with that. But we want to make sure we've got enough of money to cover what other take on.
Yeah, I mean, if they walk out the door tomorrow and say, we don't care about our money, we're not doing a punch list, and we have enough money retained to finish what they have to
Fine. Do. Okay. That's all. Thank you.
What they've requested or they identified as problems.
Town hall? Did we ever get anything back from Kevin Shea?
No, Kevin Shea never sent anything back.
Okay, well, you owe the updated price, or at least to look at what we have is correct and current, and then we owe the plan. He was going to do the diagrams for COA and the impact on the kitchen area.
Yeah, and I'm a little surprised that he hasn't produced that.
Okay. Well,
I mean, I'll make another phone call to him.
We owe that. Transportation use?
Work in progress.
Okay.
I found some old documentation, though, this week at the highway garage. Had a bunch of stuff up there from when it was originally put in place. So we're going through that now, and we'll come up with a policy.
Well, it's helpful for folks who work there so that they don't end up in arguments unnecessarily, and they're not ones provoking the arguments, just to have something in writing that they can show to folks. But it is intended for towns folks, not for contractors.
Correct.
Well, we just need to get it.
Yep.
Help them do their job. Okay. Anything else?
I'd just like to bring up the replacement of the boiler at the wastewater treatment plant.
Oh, yeah.
So there seems to be some confusion. So I talked to Brian McGrath today. It appears he's handling that.
The boiler at the highway garage failed. Wastewater plant, rather.
Yes.
Excuse
wastewater
me.
Plant.
Failed.
Right.
It's original to the building.
Okay,
right.
And it's winter.
All right, the town has an obligation to provide contractors, vendors with the prevailing wages. We should be making that request. I did file a written request today electronically. I told Brian I would do that.
Okay.
That should have been done first thing to give to the vendors before we can receive a quote from them. So he said that he has two other quotes, and I said to him that once I receive those prevailing wages, I will make them available to him. And the reason this came to light yesterday was I received a call from a contractor in Greenfield, and he's left a message here at Town Hall for someone several times, and he hasn't received a call back. And he was told he needed to talk to somebody about prevailing wages. I don't know who that person, maybe it's me, I don't know. I identified myself, but he didn't think it was me. In any case, I told Brian that he needs to provide those two other vendors with the prevailing wages, as long as we have met our obligation. And specifications, the vendor from Greenfield would like some specifications. He said it would be helpful. So, I mean, typically you do talk to a contractor and look at what you need to do and develop those. So it's something we need to get taken care of.
Okay. Well, is it on track now?
Is it what?
On track?
Yeah, I mean, like,
okay.
Well, you know, Brian has had people there to look at what the existing system is, and, you know, they've all said that you'll spend more repairing it than replacing it, so.
Right.
But, you know, it's a unique system because it's in the wastewater plant, so.
Right.
You have to be careful what you're putting in there.
Right. Well, and
well, this needs a little emphasis, I would assume, given we're in December.
Yeah.
So.
Yeah, I mean, as soon as they have the prevailing wages, I mean, they can look at the quotes that they submitted.
The contractor wanted to know if prevailing wages would apply, and I said, unless Brian's installing the boiler, yes, they would apply. So we're talking about having the equipment removed, a hot water heater removed, the furnace, and installing a new boiler.
Yeah.
Okay.
So prevailing wages do comply.
Okay. We've invited the assessors and treasurer and accountant in tonight because we have a very important issue to kind of at least put on the table. And the issue is the inability to set our tax rate timely. And this is absolutely no fault of the assessors. The assessors have done everything that they need to be doing, but there are issues. We have a new accountant and a new treasurer who've inherited a number of problems with our financial records. They've been working hard to resolve them, but it remains a work in progress. As many of you have seen before our last audit, one of the key things there was failure to do reconciliations, and they've been finding issues in prior years. Our accountant's only been here, 6 months or 7 months, but even in prior years, and they're trying to get all this cleaned up. We asked Derek to come in and talk tonight about what some of the issues are that he's facing and kind of the way ahead and what we see as a timeline and how this might all get resolved.
Well, I think you basically hit on it. Basically, you know, a lot of the work just wasn't getting put on the books. And you guys had your treasurer pass away, which certainly creates an upset in the flow of information between offices, which might have been part of the problem. But we basically needed to get all that work on the books before we could even analyze it. And I just finished getting the monthly operational journal entries on the books end of November, beginning of December. The receipts were put on the books.
This is for 14, or 15, rather.
Correct.
Fiscal year 15, the prior fiscal year.
Correct. And like you said, the reconciliations weren't done. You know, accountants can make mistakes and fat finger an accountant and book something to the wrong account, but normally a reconciliation will bring that out. And they'll go, oh, wrong account, and they'll fix it. If nobody's going back and taking a look and saying, oh, made a mistake and not fixing it, you don't see that till the end of the year when we're trying to do the overall financial review. You know, the big one was that there was an article at your special town meeting in December that wasn't put on the books. And that's really what threw us into finding the deficit. Going forward, we realized we have the deficit. Right now, I'm going through all of our fund balances, taking a look to see if we have any accounts that are, or projects rather, that are completed that we can close out. If any of the money that was used to fund those projects, we can, through taxation, we can use that to close the gap on the deficit. If we borrowed for these projects, we're not going to be able to use the money. I expect in the next 2 weeks to review all of the fund balances and have some numbers back to you, at least of what I was able to find for available money to cover the deficits.
So, to the point, if we do find in this process sufficient money to cover the deficit that appears to exist at the moment, we don't need a special town meeting. Is that correct?
That is correct.
And we can go ahead working with DOR on getting a blessing for estimated tax rates? Is that right, or do we use regular?
Did you say estimated?
Yeah, let me, go ahead.
We can't send out estimated tax bills.
That's correct.
Unless there's a problem with the valuation and there are no issues. The assessors have all their work done.
So if we get this squared away, the numbers, then what? What's the next step after that?
Regardless, at this point, if our tax bills aren't postmarked by December 31st,
have to wait till May.
Then they're due May 1st, regardless of when they're sent out.
Okay.
Which, you know, that's, you know, going to create another issue in the collector's office, but.
And a cash flow issue.
Right, and of course, we don't know exactly what we're looking at this point until we have more of an idea of when we'll be setting the rate and sending out the bills, but you know, none of the banks or the large tax service companies, none of those will make payment until May 1st. So, you know, we probably will be looking at some type of short-term borrowing that the treasurer's office will take care of. And, you know, the other issue is that a lot of people like to make tax payments prior to December 31st
for tax purposes.
And there's no place for me to post those payments to in the collector's office. So that's an issue that we're going to have to address. You know, I can talk to Marlene about that, what our options may or may not be.
Well, some of the issues, Derek's shared a few of them, examples where we had veteran services activities charged against, was it water or sewer?
It was a sewer capital project.
Just
bizarre.
And that's
bizarre and sloppy.
Those are the kinds of things that our new treasurer and new accountant have been dealing with for some months, and as a consequence, leading us to where we are today. But again, the point is the assessors here have done whatever they need to do. The burden's not on them, the burden's over here.
So, best case scenario, if we were to put timelines on this, if you find what you find and everything's reported properly, when will the forms be ready for submission on a best case scenario and on a worst case scenario, so that we have a time frame here that we can work within?
I wish I had a good idea to tell you. I mean, I can keep you updated, but it depends what I dig out. I mean, I can tell you, you know, a couple of weeks, but if I start going through and pulling out that we've got transactions that aren't even booked in the right area, it could take longer.
So if you're saying two weeks, then we're looking definitely past December 31st at this point, between holidays, vacations, getting in touch with people, submitting. And then the DOR is not going to spin a number around right away. They're going to take it and...
Yeah, I would say we're not going to have bills out by December 31st.
Correct. So I guess that would be the selectmen's preparation to make folks aware that tax bills won't come out in time.
Ron, Mr. Butzka?
Well, I'm just thinking, Jen or Laura Lee, you know, our values are set by us being held up a month, say, hypothetically. Will that have any impact with the DOR as far as the
values?
No,
they've approved the values. Those aren't going to change.
Okay.
But the sooner that we do have an idea of when that will, you know, help, you know, as far as, you know, getting a handle on, you know, if we need to borrow, for how long we may need to borrow, what we will need to borrow, and also what to tell taxpayers as far as, you know, those that want to make payments.
Jeff, is this something that requires additional support from outside the office?
We have been getting additional support here, and we are getting it from an auditor, outside auditor. Ronnie, I'm sorry, did you have something?
No, we're just on hold, I guess, Jen, right? We can't, we've done everything we can, and we're just on hold until the forms are completed and the information's provided.
Again, this is not an assessor issue. It's on the other side here. I'm sorry, Mike? Yes.
Question, yeah. Sure. Is the deficit you guys are talking about, is that fiscal 14? Is it fiscal 15? Is it both?
You had a deficit in 14, and you also had a deficit in 15.
For the fiscal year 15, there was a deficit as well?
Correct.
So obviously, when you combine the two, there's a, you know, that has an obvious effect on our balance sheet. And the tax rate can't be set until fiscal 14 is straightened out and fiscal 15 is straightened out?
14 was straightened out. You covered your deficit. We've discovered the deficit in 15 that we need to cover.
Okay.
So we have a
balanced
budget.
Yeah. The special town meeting in December 15th covered the deficit of 14.
You okay?
Yeah, and I guess my other question is, you know, we've been audited for the last 2 years, 14 and 15. Mm-hmm. The auditors didn't catch this deficit?
The auditors...
Which is kind of surprising.
Yeah, they...
It's a full audit.
They did not catch this particular issue.
15 hasn't been audited yet.
Yeah, I know. He's talking about 14 and 13.
Right.
They did highlight their lack of reconciliations.
Right.
Which is one of the major contributors to where we are.
Right.
But to your point, no.
And how about 13? 13 is closed out and is accurate as far as we're concerned?
Far as I know. It was before my time, but it's been closed and we've moved forward.
Okay. Well, we just wanted to get all this on the table and everybody have a sense of where we are and where we're headed. Who's got the ball and the heavy lifting here? Thank you very much. Appreciate it.
All right. Well, thank you.
Wish we had better news. But.
Don't be all. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, Derek.
Derek.
Town administrator.
Okay. Thank you. First, I'm just following up to the discussion we had at our meeting December 8th. The Board of Selectmen had reviewed a letter that they were addressing to the HRA, Hatfield Redevelopment Authority. In your packet is a copy of that letter that was submitted to the HRA. And at that meeting on the 8th, we also discussed, or it was referenced, Massachusetts General Law, Chapter 121, B, Section 7, and there was a question as to whether the HRA may use the services of legal counsel. So that was researched. Town Council provided us with some information, and a copy of that letter is in your packet as well. So both letters have been sent out to the HRA. Okay. And just for clarification, in the letter in your packet, Town Council does reference Massachusetts General Law Chapter 121B, Section 7 provides in pertinent part as follows. So far as practicable, a redevelopment authority shall make use of the services of the agencies, officers, and employees of the city or town in which such authority is organized, and such city or town shall, if requested, make available such services. The term, so far as practicable, is defined as capable of being carried out successfully. So Town Council does cite action of town meeting and his communication with the chairman of the HRA, and also a letter that was dated November 2nd to him by Mr. Grossman, the chairman of the HRA. So it's further his opinion that legal services do not need to be provided to the HRA.
Okay. Mm-hmm.
The next item is ambulance abatements. You had received some ambulance abatements last week, and that report omitted April, May, and June. So I'm requesting the selectmen to...
Is there a motion to approve ambulance abatements for the months of April, May, and June 2015 in the amount of $14,199.92?
So moved.
I'll second. Any other discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
I received a letter from Superintendent John Robert. Jennifer Williams, who was on the school committee, submitted her letter of resignation, and the school committee was going to be taking that issue up at their December 14th meeting, which was last night, and they will notify us. Normally what the Board of Selectmen and the school committee do is vote jointly to appoint someone in the interim.
Okay.
So we'll wait to hear from them. I'm recommending two appointments to the Recreation Committee. There are two vacancies. We've received three letters of interest. I did receive a telephone call today from the Recreation Commission, committee member Bridget Rodrigue, and the committee met last night. They've reviewed these applicants. They're very excited to have all three on there, and of course they're proposing that We increased the membership of the rec committee, adding associate members, and we're going to be looking at developing a charter for the rec committee. But at this time, I'm just asking that the Board of Selectmen appoint two individuals. The Recreation Committee is recommending Joe Punska and David Zanone. Scott McCoy is the other individual who has expressed interest. The reason the Rec Committee is recommending David Zanone is he has interest in improving the summer camp. The sooner he's appointed, the sooner he can start working on that. And then once we've completed the charter and changed the membership of the committee, then we'd like to appoint Scott McCoy. So my recommendation is to appoint Joe Punska and David Zanone.
Just for folks. So move. Second. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Just for folks watching, the Rec Committee was in here on the 8th of December. Excuse me. Yeah, 8th of December. And there were a couple of issues that had been raised in an earlier Board of Selectmen meeting concerning their operation, concerning their compliance with open meeting laws, concerning with failure to announce a basketball program, concerns about folks being siphoned off to other teams. Anyway, we had a very good discussion concerning that. A couple of things that came out of that was, you know, they're limited in terms of resources. They're very much hands-on. The membership takes on particular projects and runs with them and orchestrates everything with respect to them. And at the time they came, they had two vacancies. Mm-hmm. At that meeting, we filled...
Well, there was one vacancy.
Oh, I'm sorry.
Another was created by the selectmen.
We rescinded the appointment of one other individual because he never showed up for over a year and a half or a year plus and never was sworn in. So we rescinded that. So we had two vacancies to fill. They're very appreciative of that. We're doing that tonight, filling two of their vacancies. And the other thing they brought up was it would be helpful if they had kind of a bench, something like a series of alternates who we could appoint and they could participate and help out and attend all the meetings. And when an individual member was not there, they would have voting privilege. Otherwise, they could participate but not vote. Anyway, we're looking at amending the charter for Rec Committee to do that, to provide them some bench strength, essentially. So that's great. They're on track, and they do a lot for the town. We appreciate that. Sir?
It seems, my recollection from a week ago when we met with the Recreation Commission, that there was an issue with one then-existing member. And you suggested that you withdraw his appointment.
We did.
Has that been done?
We did that night.
Oh,
immediately,
okay.
After they left.
Sorry.
He hadn't participated for a year, year and a half.
Yeah.
Never was sworn in, so he couldn't.
Yeah, no, that makes sense.
They had a hole. License renewals.
In your packet, you have all the license renewals for 2016, including the inspection report from the building inspector and the fire chief. This includes also the local licenses, liquor licenses, local licenses, and class 1, 2, and or 3 licenses. And I would request that the board approve those as presented in your packet.
Yeah, we don't have to go through them
individually. No, we can, as submitted.
So move.
The motion is to approve
the minutes will reflect those
as
licenses.
Submitted.
Mm-hmm.
Second, any other discussion? All in favor?
Aye. Here for 2 more hours with the number of licenses.
We do have 1 more license to discuss. Why don't we take this one out of turn? This other we do have 1 other license here. The Motor Works.
At this time, I'm not asking the selectmen to take action.
Okay.
There's still some research that needs to be done. As far as the zoning goes, it's possible they may require a special permit from the planning board.
Okay, so we'll table the request of Mr. Is it LaRario?
Ferrari, right, at 170.
Yes, sir. Well, would you like to, you can come forward. We're going to table the matter because certain issues about zoning that we need to clarify.
Well, we can give you this, give you a better understanding of what the business is and where we're going with it.
Yes, sir. There's not an issue about what you're doing. It's just a matter of coordinating with the zoning. I don't know when this was received.
Yeah, I just received this the end of last week, and so I'm just doing the research, and I need to verify the zoning. And
we'll be glad to take it up in the next meeting.
In accordance with the zoning bylaws, a special permit may be required.
Okay, great.
But I will be in touch with you.
Thank you, sir.
We have also received a request for extended hours, New Year's Eve, and I failed to follow up this afternoon, Keith.
All right.
Can I tap your memory?
Is there a motion to approve Double D Bar and Grill request to extend their hours to 2 a.m. Vice 1 on New Year's Eve?
Are we going to do this on an individual basis then, or?
Were you looking for clarification on something?
I am.
Yeah,
I am.
Before I second that motion.
If Key recalls.
The problem is we're not meeting. This is the only one we received.
That's why I'm raising this question.
This is the only one we received, the only request. So I think in fairness, we should act on this request.
Yeah.
Oh, yes, I agree.
I don't have any argument with that.
I agree.
I just want to make sure Marlene is on board. She's the one presenting.
Between now and New Year's, if we receive any other requests, that's my concern. We would not be meeting.
Well, as I understand the open meeting law, the Board of Selectmen, acting in their licensing capacity, mm-hmm. are not required to post a meeting. We can, as licensees, or whatever the term is, we can act. So anyway, I think in fairness, we ought to act on the one we have.
Absolutely.
And
I agree.
If any more come in, then we'll deal
take
with
them.
It.
Okay.
Either have a meeting or somehow act on them.
Okay.
Two things. I don't want to make it, I'm not making an issue or question as to whether we should follow through on this. I just wanted to make sure that Marlene, our town administrator's input, was being reflected in the final product. And you're comfortable with that?
I am.
Okay, I'll second that motion.
Okay. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Please note that key in the minutes, please. Thank you.
Pilot.
And the pilot, just to update the board, I will be meeting with a representative from NextAmp tomorrow, and also a member of the Board of Assessors, Larry Williams, and Pat.
That's at 1:30, right?
That's at 1:30 here at the town hall. So it's an informal discussion. Mm-hmm. Regarding the property out on North Hatfield Road.
Good.
And I will update the Board of Selectmen.
What about the activity on Plain Road? Has
I have not
ever
received any
this?
Information. Received any information about that.
Okay.
So, yeah, hopefully we'll be making some progress on that.
Have we given Pat some background material on
I have the materials
pilot agreements? Did we ever get a copy?
Actually, I did get a copy from Deerfield. They're just starting.
Oh, I'm sorry. I thought they had something done.
Yeah, they're just starting. They do have a draft agreement, but they have not. They're just starting the negotiations.
Okay. This is for a payment in lieu of taxes for a solar farm on North Hatfield Road. And
it's private property.
NextAmp is planning, and been through planning board, and they're planning to do this and want to work with the town on setting up a payment in lieu of taxes. So it's an agreement required. It maintains the same amount of taxes, but essentially levels the payment, which makes it easier for them up front in terms of the financing, and it provides the town kind of a level stream of income that we could plan on over a period of time. And the key in the agreement is to take care of all the loose ends, like what if they fail, how is it, what if they add units, what if they take out units, how is all that handled? There's a variety of things, but
right.
the financing is one piece, but there's a lot of other very important pieces that go into the agreement that need to be worked.
And that's on equipment only?
Right.
The pilots and equipment only. So, I just, unanticipated new business. The Board of Selectmen and the DPW Director received a letter from James and Teresa Klepacki at 69 Elm Street. They're requesting to have the town remove the street sign. I did forward this to Town Council, and as you know, that we have been we're sort of in transition, waiting for a response from Town Council regarding the issuing of permits for property off of Little Neponset. And Town Council sent an email to me late yesterday. He is recommending that we table this for now, and he is referring the documents he received from Attorney Melnick to Stanley Szymanski's attorney for review.
I know that's not the answer you wanted to hear, but they're apparently, even though by all appearance to date, it's not a public way.
Right.
It was not part of an approved subdivision.
That's correct.
Now they're looking at, was it a way, and I don't know how a way is defined in law, before the Subdivision Control Act was approved by town.
Right.
So that's one other loose end to all this, and hopefully it gets resolved soon, but at least it's in work for you. And as soon as we get anything, we'll get back.
The last item I have is a former center school. And I spoke with the contractor that was overseeing the study of that building, the asbestos removal, and the demolition bylaw, of course, superseded moving forward with demolition of that building. However, though, we will have to rebid the demolition. I did confirm that. I spoke with the engineer. He said for his services, though, it'll be probably around $3,000.
Okay.
So I just need to get with the town accountant and look at monies that we have available. There's anything left over from that project.
Okay.
And that is all I have.
Is there a motion to go in executive session in accordance with Massachusetts General Law, Chapter 38, Section 21, Number 3, to discuss strategy with respect to collective bargaining for DPW, and the board will not be returning to open session?
So move.
It's a roll call vote.
Aye.
Gone, aye. Boyle, aye. All in favor? Approved. Motion to adjourn?
So move.
Second. All in favor?
Aye. Adjourn and go into executive session.
Yes.
Okay.
And we're not coming back to open meeting.
We're going to stay.